In my big dream imagining, we get to distill the deepest stories and the truths that come out of community and out of history. When we have our voices heard and have our messages heard, we become leaders.
Yitzap Oweli al Siaya Siam Si Alakwa Ich Imakne Etan Antha Jada Gabriel Pape Antha Wu Wasselwat. Welcome to the Drawing Wisdom Video Podcast. We're in season 3. We're in conversation today with Valerie Nicholson.
Val, it's so nice to be with you.
It's so good to be back with you. Thank you so much.
So here we are. We're doing the Drawing Wisdom Video Podcast, and I feel really, really grateful I get to be in conversation with you because we've worked together and spent time in wonderful conversation. And I feel like in our conversations, I learn an enormous amount from you, but I also get pretty inspired. And I think our listeners should know who I'm sitting in conversation with. So tell me what people would know you as and also what you carry.
Thank you so much for having me. It's so good to see you. I go by Valerie, but I am gifted the name, the one the eagles watch over, and that was gifted to me 4 days after my birth. I was also gifted the name Nodi Wenda, which means wolf eyes, from a Dene family, and was gifted the name Auntie from the Torres Strait Islanders.
We carry so many responsibilities with our names, and I know that you're really aware of the power of responsibilities as Indigenous people, as Hualmuch, Mestayoch. And I wonder, when you think about some of the responsibilities you carry, not necessarily from your names, but walking in the world, what are some of the ways that you live in reciprocity?
Wow, where do I start? I'm thinking of my names and connection. And I was actually going to say the connection with nature. And look, we had a voice from nature come right in. So it was actually pretty well prompting me to recognize the importance of it is to walk in this world. And, you know, I may not have known my history throughout my life, but to learn it as I've been growing and learning. But I've always walked with nature. I've always had my ancestors beside me and walking with me, and they are my teachers. And I think that is, and then sharing that with those that I work with, but especially my children and grandchildren, that is my responsibility.
Mm-hmm. I feel like so now we've got the sounds in our podcast of dogs snoring, dogs barking, dogs climbing over recording equipment, and us, mm-hmm. So yeah. We're a full house.
I wouldn't want it any other way.
I feel like the teachings that we gain from being with the land and the waters, part of that is like the ancients, but then I think how we interpret it in the world we live in now. And I think part of what my experience is when the two of us are in conversation is that I see you as being really humble and really graceful. And I think what that does is it makes people feel safe with you. And I wonder, who are the people who are drawn to you? Who do you spend your time with?
Well, thank you for saying that. That really filled my heart and spirit. I don't know really how to answer that, because when I was growing up and was even in high school, I was in grade 12 before I realized that people were categorized by who they were. And I just thought we were all one human race. I did not see anyone as being Asian or coming from East India, or I just thought we were all one people. And it was my grade 12 graduation, we had to vote for a valedictorian. And I can still remember his name. And somebody said, who did you vote for? and I spoke his name, and I got severely beaten up, because why would I vote for someone, as they said, was East Indian? He was not, you know, white. And I got, and that was the day that my eyes were open to racism and hate. I didn't know why I was picked on for all those years. I don't know why I was called a chug or a wagon burner. Really horrible words. But I always looked at the positive in that. I thought, oh yeah, I just chug along. You know, I didn't, and that's what I thought it meant. I always see the good in people. I don't see that negativity. And that really opened my eyes, and I wondered, why are we like that? And I guess I've tried to teach my children and grandchildren that we're all human first. We have to be inclusive. And I think that's what people are drawn to, is that peacefulness maybe, or acceptance.
I think for me, I like that I don't see people all as one. I see people as very distinct and very different and upholding of their cultures and their backgrounds. And I like that. And I also feel like where there is great commonality is in how do we behave. That's a difference that I know has changed in the world. Like, we're starting to understand you can be racist, but don't behave racist. Like, your thoughts can have a bias, but don't behave it. And I also think when we find safe spaces to have those conversations and be around people where we know we can relax into the conversation, I think it changes everything. And part of what you're talking about, like those, I mean, it's a funny thing to take being called chug as a kid and find the strength in it and the positive and totally misgauge it and misread it. But I think there's power in language, right? Language shapes our thought. And that's actually something we were talking about right before we started recording, was some of the language that is really bristling with you these days. And I wonder if we want to wade into a little bit of that.
Thank you, Grandfather. It's funny because I hadn't even thought about chug in years. I am sort of been called a word warrior because I do work in research and I'm living with HIV, and I look at also as HIV as a gift, because I couldn't do the work that I do today. You know, I've traveled, I've done so many impactful and wonderful things. And when I started looking at the research and the words that we used, and I have been asked to speak at for medical classes at UBC and SFU, and the youth coming up and facing much stigma and discrimination in the healthcare system. And then I started going back to the research and looking at the words that people were writing, and having to remind them, like, when you're writing about these stats or these graphs, there's voices behind there, there's people. And they seem to forget that because they just see numbers coming in on there. And they'll write about it. And my first one I did when I first started, oh gosh, it's going back 20 years now in research, was they would stand up at conferences and talk about mother-to-child transmission for HIV. And I just sat back and I went, whoa, why would you say that? That mom is carrying a life. She has enough on her plate. She has to think about what HIV is doing to her, what it's doing to the baby. And now we're publicly talking about this as mother-to-child transmission. And I stood up and I asked, you know, why are you using that? When you talk about me, you don't say man-to-woman transmission. So why are we singling out this mom? Or life giver, you know, and other people heard it. So throughout this conference for a week, I would stand up at everyone that would say it and ask, what could we say differently? Why are you blaming the mom? Because it seemed to be very blaming. And then other people would stand up. It's like you tell two people who tell two people. And it is now changing. And they have in vitro, they have vertical transmission. So the healthcare has changed it. And then I started really listening, and words like intervention, like you have to take your meds, we're doing an intervention. And I'm going, no, you know, 60 Scoop was an intervention. Residential school was an intervention. Telling somebody what to do, that's top down. It's like they're standing above you telling, you know. And I thought, as growing up as a child, if my parents told me to do something, I would do the opposite, you know, because I didn't have a choice in that. And I thought, why aren't we doing that? So I asked many people that were writing their theses, and they would use the word intervention because that is the terminology in that world. And I said, if you could change that word, what would it be? And they couldn't come up with anything. And I was sitting at a PHAC, which is a medical Canada, and they were using intervention for some stuff that was coming out in a brochure. And I said, no, I don't. And I explained again what intervention means to a lot of people. And they said, what word would you use? And I still didn't have an idea. And it was like one of my ancestors just came, and it came right out my mouth, positive action. And they went, yeah. Then it's like circular. It's, we're making that decision together. I'm not telling you what to do. And we get to make a choice, an informed choice. And an elder, Elder Sheila Nyman, added to that, add the word healthy when it's appropriate. Healthy, positive action, or positive, healthy action. So that is one of the words that I'm changing. Trigger is another one, because that is a very triggering word also. You know, oh, they've been triggered. Well, no, they've been activated. And it's activated either spiritually, their spirit, their mind, heart, or body. There is a reaction. So we can use softer words and to remember who we're talking about and why we're talking about it.
Yeah, I really appreciate what you're saying in that we can use softer words, but they're actually words that are more truthful, mm-hmm. right? So they don't have the bias against whether it's mothers or Indigenous people or people living with HIV. They have a story built into it that tells more about the well-rounded, full person. And there's like that piece around what might have been called mother to child reduces that person to nothing more, one, than mother, and nothing more than pregnant, and nothing more than somebody living with HIV. It takes away the whole story. I think that's one of the real big barriers that we experience in healthcare, is that we are not whole people. We are what the small sliver of ourself, and we're not there because things are going really, really well. We're there because there's something we're grappling with in the health of our lives. And I think experts, like doctors, are seen as experts, and researchers are seen as experts. And I think for them to hear the impact of their words and to be invited into that conversation, and hopefully they're receiving it with some humility.
Some, a lot, but you know, it's a learning journey, and it's a habit that we have to break. One of the other words that just came to my mind that we've been really working on is, a lot of them will say, we're fostering a relationship, or we're fostering this. And there's so many that as soon as they hear that word foster, they go right back to foster care. And you know, we can cultivate, we can nurture. There's so many words that are, you know, and you know, we've been taught these words, mm-hmm. and it's like a habit that we have to get out of.
I would never say, yeah. I'm fostering a I'm building a relationship. Yeah. I'm spending time with this person. Like, there's so many ways to break out of the language that is actually very elitist, right? Like, it's language that comes from the academy, that comes from, you know, the medical system. And as soon as we bring it back to the people and center the people, like, we want language to reflect the people who are most impacted by it. And if the people who are most impacted can't be in that conversation, if we're being, you know, part of, like, the word being triggered, actually what the experience is we're being brought into a whole nother time in our life where we were being injured, where we didn't have control or power. And so to reduce it to triggered removes a lot of what the experience is for that person. And I think it's like, that's so violent in itself. I mean, on top of using violent language, it's a violent act to take someone's story away. And I think we have to be so mindful in I mean, we have to be really mindful with our words, but I also think it's not just about paying attention to the words. It's also about... It's also about, like, what are we doing to be part of the medicine for people? We can't just be careful with how we speak, because we could say the right things and be a total jerk. Or we can say the right things and be part of people's medicine, and that feels like another realm altogether.
Yeah. And something my grandfather taught me when I was little was, you know, as teachers we are learners, and as learners we are teachers, and we have to keep that circle just circling.
As teachers we are learners, and as learners we are teachers. It's the most humble way to think about being in relationship. It's the way of being in a circle,
yep.
Right? There is no hierarchy, we are. Yes.
And we all bring our truths and our knowledge and, yeah. And I learned so much from the youth, like right now, working on one of the studies, and it's all on inclusiveness and sexual and the terminology that the youth want to use. And I have learned so much from them, as I'm learning from my own grandchild who has come out as trans, and understanding and taking that journey with him is just the best teachings I could give, and to be that support along this journey, because I know it's going to be a difficult one. Mm-hmm. And hopefully it won't, but you know, it shows us right now in this time and space that it is a difficult journey. Mm-hmm. And I'm so grateful that he has a voice and speaks up and stands up. Mm-hmm. And just a quick note, we went out for dinner last night, and we have a favorite place that we go to. And they greet him with open arms. He gets spoiled. He gets always a free dessert. But one of the, I don't know if they call them waitresses anymore here. I want to try and be right in my language. That staff that works there came up to me and said, his pronoun is him, isn't it? Am I right? And I said, yes, thank you. And he was just beaming from ear to ear. It was just like, he's 12, mm. Right? And to see that in community, and accidentally I said she in the elevator yesterday. And I said, you know, I have 10 years of saying she, you gotta be patient with me. I'm, you know, still learning. And, you know.
I think that's a good example of where relationship is so fundamental, that it's not fully about the language, that there is room in the relationship for both of you to grow and evolve, and to the language doesn't reflect your heart or your relationship when, you know, but you've got to be able to adapt with it. And I think that piece around it is going to get hard, that everybody will experience challenge and to various levels, right, in their lives. And so for me as a mom, who now my kid is not a baby or a toddler or, you know, is 18. And I think I can't protect my kid from the world, but what I can do is be part of a safe harbor. And that's really hard to wrestle with as a parent. And you know that we can't protect people, but can we be some of what is a safe container and see if, you know, if we're a safe place to come back to when those challenges are there. And I think we need to do that in our family circles, in our friend circles, and for you and me in our work circles as well, to remain safe harbors for people. I want to talk about the project that you're working on that is part of the medicine for so many people, and I wonder if you can teach me about it.
The gardens, okay. Sometimes I well up with this. So pre-COVID, of course, working in an office, now working from home, when the discovery of the children's graves, and, you know, we always knew that they were there. We always know that there's some graves, children that never got graves. And, you know, community was grieving. And in our office, you know, they wanted to give us space. They gave us time off, which was wonderful. but they wanted to give, but they didn't know how to interact. They didn't want to step on toes. They didn't want, you know, like culturally appropriate, you know, protocol, all these words. And, but they were being very respectful, but they came and said, like, how do we grieve also? Because we're also hurting, you know, and, you know, we don't want to step on toes, but, you know, like, what can we do? And I, at that time, I didn't have an answer. It was just like, you know, we can talk. That's the best thing. We can just talk our feelings. And, you know, it got very emotional that we'd go out and do smudges. Like, I'd bring smudge to work, or it was at work. And I had a dream. And in this dream, it was beautiful. I can still see it. It was just these fields of wildflowers as far as you could see. And there was these children, and they were holding hands, and they were running towards the sun. They had long hair, some had braids, you know, and they were just free. They were running free. And I woke up with this, I still get goosebumps. I woke up and felt, wow, you know, they are free. And then thinking about the ones where they're still not discovered, and all the ones that didn't have graves. And the next night the dream came again, just as beautiful. Third night, fourth night, I'm watching these children run, and it was almost like I got a on the head from my grandfather, who said, you have it, why aren't you doing something about it? Think, like, this is like telling me, like, just don't visualize it. Action now. And I woke up and I thought, wow, we could plant a garden. And at that time I was working with the Building More Bridges project, and we got together, and of course we were all, you know, this would be a big part of our meetings when we met, because we're all over the province and talking about this and what can we do for ourselves. So we got this beautiful cedar planter, and there was a youth that actually painted it, and we told them what they wanted painted on it. And we planted wildflowers. And, oh, memory. I can't remember what, it's in Terrace, but I don't know outside of what building, but I can let you know. And we don't have our name on it, because we want to keep some of the people safe that are living with HIV, that are still living on reserve and in remote areas. And these flowers came up. And then we were gifted, right after that, a little piece of land at First and Commercial, right between the sidewalk and the parking lot. And people from the office got their families, their partners, their children, and they were digging up, because it's just really hard land in there. And they were digging it up, and community started walking by and offering to help. And one was a stonemason, and one was a carpenter. Somebody that saw it from a building came and brought lunches for us. And the last month of building, before we planted, I wasn't allowed to go. They said, you have to stay away, there's a surprise. And they had put up a fence, because it was right by a garbage can. And they put in a place to do smudge, put medicines there, a big rock. And what came from this was, this is a place where anyone can go. We don't have to, you know, that we can grieve in the own way, pray in our own way, you know, whatever culture you come from. This is a place where we can gather and just remember these children. And it's impacted everyone. And then we had all these youth come out and plant the seeds. And there were some plants in there, and we had ceremony. But we had ceremony the day before what used to be Orange Shirt Day. Well, it still is Orange Shirt Day until our Prime Minister changed it to Truth and Reconciliation Day. Another thing they've taken away, because it is Orange Shirt Day. They should never have changed that name. So we did it the day before to really honor the Orange Shirt and the history behind it, so that it wasn't confused with the governmental Truth and Reconciliation. And we had a great turnout. We blanketed the three men that worked on it. And I remember when going out to find the blankets for these three beautiful men, there was only one orange blanket at the store, and they didn't have any more. And trying to find three in the same color, and then all of a sudden there was this one in this very unique green. It was a green, I can't even see it in your place here, but it, oh, like the cord down there, which no one can see, but it was that color green. I don't know what you'd describe it as.
Fluorescent.
Almost, and I thought, oh, this has to go to this one gentleman. And when I blanketed him, he said, my mom's last name is Green. And the other one that I blanketed, whatever design was on it, resonated with his family. And he said, this is the first day I've started to heal from residential school. This is the first day of my healing. That blanket meant so much to them. And you know, community came in that we didn't know and saw this gathering. They joined us. It was pouring rain. The little ones were putting down the seeds, and we put our hands in cement, and community came out and fed us. They just saw it and just started bringing food, and it's a wonderful garden. There are more gardens. They're on our webpage, which is Running Free Wildflower Gardens, and we have rocks for them to paint. They paint, they're beautiful, they're gorgeous. And of course we have to have four-leggeds and little ones with us. And hopefully my goal was to have a garden for every child that we've lost. And I hope to have this across our nation. So we're in contact with people in Ontario right now in different places. And we're also encouraging people to have private gardens. Mm-hmm. And we can list them as a private garden in an area, but we want to number them all now, so.
I hear a couple of things, like that it is in the earth, in the land, and that all of those children, that land is cradling and holding all of those children, but actually also spending time growing the wildflowers, growing the gardens, nurturing the snoring dogs.
Yeah. And wildflowers keep coming back. And as one of the little ones said that were there, and the bees will come back. So it's that connection with just looking after Mother Earth, looking after ourselves and grieving, and you know, and looking after others. So it's just a beautiful place to just, you know, sit and yeah. Oh, and one of my colleagues, Nilu, who took my vision, because I described it to her the morning after, actually painted a beautiful painting, which is on our website, which is hopefully we'll be putting up in every garden.
Yeah, you know, this piece about grief for our people, it's really ongoing. Like, our grief didn't start when the bodies of the children started to be recovered, because like you say, that wasn't new information. That grief has been there for 200 years since, you know, the beginning of the colonial project. And I feel like we're so accustomed to living with grief, but we've been taught, like you said, we can do the work later, like in our jobs. When that started coming to the surface and all of our systems were in a state of alarm, even though we knew, having it named, but there in the validation of that, there was so much pain and it was so raw. And so going about business as usual didn't make sense, but that is how colonialism operates. And so yeah, we'll take pause, but we've, you know, got this long, sort of like a land recognition or a territorial acknowledgement in the beginning of a meeting. Like, we'll do this, we'll spend the 30 seconds or 3 minutes, and now we're going to have the regular meeting, and nothing will be different. And so how do we make meaning of those things? And there is, like, the symbolism of a garden means that we also have to look after it, we have to tend to it. And so it teaches us about, a little bit about sustainability, and a little bit about, like, the symbolism is a prolonged relational engagement. Right, and some reciprocity.
It's life. Yeah, I was gonna say, and I would really like to name the three men: Bryce, Mike, and Danny. Yeah, they were just amazing workhorses, and all the families, of course, and the youth that came out. But those three, and like you said, it started so much healing that we didn't even know it was going to do. One person said, "I've never spoken about residential school until today." You know, when we plant that seed, who knows what's going to grow, and just I'm thankful that it's growing.
Mm-hmm. So I think that was just pre-pandemic, or in the beginning of the pandemic, when you had this vision, you had your dream, and then this has come to fruition. You didn't know it was going to happen. So all this healing that you didn't know was going to happen, it didn't just start with that. You've been doing healing for years and years and years. And I wonder, as we're sort of coming to the end of our conversation, if you could go back and talk to little Val before little Val knew all this healing was would happen, what would you tell little Val?
Wow, you're making me, oh, you're going to be okay. I've been on a rough journey, and at times I didn't know if I would survive it. And believe in yourself, just believe, and you're going to do it. I think that's the only thing I would say to myself, but you know what? I wouldn't change a thing, because I wouldn't be who I am today. And, you know, I wouldn't change anything.
I love that, that you would tell little you.
Oh, sorry.
You're going to be okay.
Yeah.
And now you can actually, big you knows you are okay.
Yeah.
And not you're going to do it. You're doing it.
Thank you.
And thank you so much for spending time with me, and for being you in the world and the way you walk. I appreciate you so much. I just love you, Val.
I love you too. Thank you so much. You carry such beautiful energy. Thank you.
And there we go. It's a wrap.
Awesome.
So that wraps up our conversation with Valerie Nicholson. In our next episode, I'll be joined by my co-conspirators, Kat Dodds and David Ng.